My culture's in the dark. My religion is a question mark. Where do I start? And that has stuck with me for 30 years. And he helped me answer those questions because I realized that I did have, didn't need to be religion. It was more about spirituality and knowledge of self. And he took me in a place where I had a starting point. And then from there, I went from studying 5% mathematics, you know, all the way to 120. I didn't really, you know, master it, but then it opened up the doors for me to study other things.
Yeah, Rob was funky. Rob was jazz. Rob was funk. Rob was street, ratchet, ghetto, knock a nigga, bump a nigga, slam dancing, rub your bitch ass at the same time, stinking ass, blunt smoking, 40 tossing, fuck a nigga up all in one. Like Rob was the street. That was the street.
When somebody talked to me about Rod, he was a man child. Like LeBron James is on a basketball court. That's how he was with the pen.
Thinking of a master plan. This ain't nothing but sweat inside my hands. So I dig into my pocket, all my money spent. So I get deeper, but still coming up with lint. So I start my mission, leave my residence. Thinking how could I get some dead presidents? I need money. I used to be a stick-up kid. So I think of all the devious things I did.
I try to keep everything dealing with, you know, reality. You know what I'm saying? Just things that take place. Like I can be riding up a block. You know, somebody that's sitting next to me that's riding with me might, you know, think it's just a regular block. But, you know, what I see is like, you know, I see the way a kid is walking up the block and I try to think about what he's thinking about. You know what I'm saying? If I see a kid walking real slow, I can put it in a, you know, rhyme form. You know what I'm saying? His feelings. You know what I'm saying? I can see an area that's like burnt down or whatever. You know what I'm saying? What I try to do is picture life before it burnt down and where the people that were staying there, you know, what happened to them when it got, you know what I'm saying? It's like I try to look through things and, you know, come up with something different.
Popo Griffin.
Yeah.
Man, we went to school together he grew up in Wine, I mean, we in Wine Dance. Always lived right up the street one way or the other.
And I always admired Griff, you know, and all musicians. I wasn't a musician, but I was into DJing and things of that matter.
Rakim represents innovator, pioneer. These are the things, these are the words that I think of when I think of Rakim. Legend, you know, one of the first people to take lyricism to another level.
Rakim to this day, just to people, is still one of the greatest MCs ever. That's enough said.
And now you have everybody trying to duplicate the culture and duplicate my era. Meaning that your jewelry you wear, your clothes you wear, and how you wear them, your haircut, the jewelry, your slang, everything comes from the culture.
It's been a long time.
In the beginning, William Griffin Jr. was surrounded by music. From his mom's being a singer and his brothers playing instruments, it was almost predestined that he would have something to do with sound or music before the age of 12. Jazz music, break beats, keyboards, turntables was his introduction to music and flows of melody.
My brother played the piano, my sister sang, my other brother played the sax and piano. I played the sax and drums, you know, so it's like, it helps me a lot when, you know, I sit down and write rhymes. I know different musical backgrounds and things of that nature. And it just, you know, put me that much deeper into it.
Me and Griff got together. He came over to my house and saw me making beats. And he brought his saxophone. So we had I had scratches and beats and break beats. He had his saxophone. Eventually, at some given point, we ended up with a keyboard. Because Griff knew how to play the keyboard, learned from his older brother, Ronnie.
Rob, peace to the God. Peace to the God. Peace to the Griffin family.
peace to my brother Stevie Blass.
Oh man, what can I say about Rakim? I can say Rakim, I first met Rakim at 12 or 13-ish, about 12. Child prodigy.
I guess Blass admired what I was doing on the turntables. So Blass would come over, I would do some turntable stuff and teach him how to spin. And then eventually he would bring his saxophone over and I would scratch beats and run break beats. I would run break beats over his saxophone and then we would record that onto cassettes.
The Griffin family and my family, we're very close. The siblings, my brothers and sisters went to school. We all went to school together. Me and Stevie's a year apart. My brother, Leo, went to, and his sister Steph is about the same age. My sister Thea and Ronald, which is Rakim's oldest brother, is about the same age.
I think since I was young, man, because of the influences around me, you know, my oldest brother was already out there in the mix. My brother under him, Stevie Blass, that's the one that plays keyboards, moved the crowd and all that for me back in the day. Again, he played sax, my sister sang, so I was always around music. And, you know, back then coming up as a kid, you know, if it wasn't Michael Jackson or, you know, Stevie Wonder or, you know, Cool and the Gang, you know, we was always influenced by what was going on and we wanted to be stars, you know, at a young age. I know at least I did.
Well, doing something with the turntable and teaching him how to mix, and he was showing me records they had. Their mother and father had an incredible jazz collection. And we decided to go to the store to go buy some beer. So we left out the basement door, went to the store to buy a couple of quarts of beer. At this time, they didn't have 40 ounces. It wasn't invented yet. And when we got back, my turntable was spinning. And I was like, Blast, like, well, we didn't call him Blast at the time. I was like, Griff, who been messing with my turntable? And he turned and said, nobody. There's nobody down here. Nobody will come down here. I said, I never take my needle and leave my needle off the little holder there on the turntable. And why is the record spinning? Next thing you know, we heard some feet shuffling and this little dude went running up the steps and we went to go chase him and we couldn't catch him. He was too fast. And that's the first time I didn't meet him, but that was Rakim at 10 years old messing with my turntable, which is why today I say my turntable was the first professional turntable Rakim ever seen.
Known as Kid Wiz or Kid Wizard at first, he had the ferociousness of a lion, but was smooth as a bird in the wind on the mic. Everyone from his hood knew there was something special about William Griffin Jr. Known to be the youngest out of his crew, the Love Brothers, he began to make a name for himself right into high school.
And Rod was, I gotta say it, I know this sounds cliche and corny, but from the beginning he was special. I gotta give it to him, and everybody knew it.
I wasn't just hearing 1, 2, 3, 4. I was saying 1, 2, 3, and 4, and whatever. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I started realizing, yo, if I can, you know, fill in all of this space with rhythms and you know, intellectual words that, you know, grab them in 4 or 5 syllable words and you know what I mean? I figured out, you know, I can make the same rhythms that he was making by using certain syllable words and using certain syllable words after each other, you know what I mean? So I took it from a float and a float and float and then gold and a blown and a to blown down, diddle, blown, diddle, blown.
My first MC name was Kid Wizard, man.
Can write rhymes, recite rhymes so smoothly to the point where you would think that he was doing a freestyle, but it wasn't really a freestyle, but it was a freestyle. But he would write it.
No, I just used to always thought if I can grab their attention from the first couple bars, then they'll listen to the rest of the song, you know what I mean? And also,
I don't know, the beginning of the song, the first thing you say on the song is almost, you know, and that's every song, is almost like, you know, your first impression.
And my affiliation with some of the groups, the old school hip-hop, Goofy Chill, had a little, some demo session with Rakim, plus, you know, the music, he was in the hood rapping, Kid Wiz, Kid Wizzy.
Rakim, as growing up, got with a few dudes that were neighbors with him. G-Stro.
Well, that's what I was hearing. G-Stro, him and Cool Breeze.
Stephen Pye was the Snake. Ron Drew.
Ballin' was the DJ. And,
So, when they got with Cool Breeze and the Love Brothers, it was like, you know, Cool Breeze had the system. He had the popularity and the MCs, and it was like that was a lot to deal with. And Rod was probably like 13, maybe barely 14 at that. And that's where that crew was like this. They took over the whole area. See, the thing about it too, like I said before, if you had a pass, like Amityville was doing their thing. Wine Dance, we was doing our thing. And the two parks and the 2 days you would do it at is Amityville Day and Wine Dance Day.
Everybody knew that there was backyard parties, and they knew it would wait for him to get on that mic, because I know he would destroy it, you know? They knew he was gonna say something innovative, and he was ahead of his time, you know? He wasn't a god then. He was the Kid Wiz at the time. You know, he was young. He was running with a lot of older dudes that was maybe 2, maybe 3 years older than him at the time. And he was doing things that maybe at his age he shouldn't have been doing.
It was like you knew Rakim was coming out with some new gear or some new whatever, or you knew Cool Breeze was going to bring a new record, or you knew Almighty G-Stro or Blade or Snake or Ron Drew, they was going to do something that they would attract 1,000 people in the park by themselves, because you want to know what they was doing, you know what I mean? They was like the next thing, you know? So, yeah, they was a serious crew.
When I started hearing him on the radio, at the block parties back then, you know, I was like, man, this kid's nice. And I wanted to be so much a part and give my contribution into hip hop, into the hip hop culture, you know. I was like, yo, this dude, man, he might be, yo, he could do something, he could be something, you know.
Can write rhymes, recite rhymes so smoothly to the point where you would think that he was doing a freestyle, but it wasn't really a freestyle, but it was a freestyle. But he would write.
I hold the mic as hostage, I'm seized as ransom. Rhymes are punishing because they don't understand them. I heat up his brain, then explain, then I hand him a red hot microphone. That's how I brand them. Rhymes fall in formation, unite and ignite. Like a platoon putting bullet wounds in the mic. If you curse me, it ain't no mercy. Give him an autopsy, killed by a verse of me. I took a kid and cut off his eyelids. Kill him slow so he can see what I did. And if he don't understand what I said, I'm pushing his eyeballs way to the back of his head so we can see what he's getting into. A part of the mind that he never been through. The journey is coming because you're getting sent to a place harder to find, but it's all in the mental. I run a brain scan to locate his game plan. When I'm through with his brain, he ain't the same man. Did he lose his mind or lost in his mind? But this ain't the loss and found, because you can't find.
So in stacks and stacks of books he would have. Stacks and stacks. You mean just right. And when he pulled one out on you, it's a problem.
What I do when I'm writing, I'm putting down my life, you know what I'm saying? And you know, I don't believe in writer's block, so when I get to the point where, you know, I'm getting slow on the ink, I just put the pen down, then I go back out in the world and live. So, you know, I'm not rhyming, I'm just thinking, you know what I'm saying? So when I get back to the paper, I got more life to put down.
But he had done something, man, and it was a different thing he was doing, and he blew me away. I could never rhyme in front of him again after that. So he started to grow in popularity in the neighborhood. Those tapes that I made was circulating around the neighborhood.
The Love Brothers was a crew that helped Rakim sharpen his skills on the mic and develop that slow flow that is his trademark. Not too long after that, he would experiment with recording demos with local neighborhood producers and childhood friends, DJ Maniac and Nate Tinsley, along with Rakim's older brother, Stevie.